Hi, I'm Arnie Gunderson from Fairwinds. Last week, Tokyo Electric announced that the core inside the nuclear reactor had definitely melted through and had also melted partly through the containment at Fukushima. I wanted to talk about that today because I think there's been a lot of exaggerations and misunderstandings on the internet about what's actually going on. So the question I'd like to talk about today is, can Fukushima become what's called the China syndrome? And what exactly does the China syndrome really mean?
I don't know. They might have come close to exposing the core.
If that's true, then we came very close to the China syndrome.
The what?
If the core is exposed, for whatever reason, the fuel heats beyond core heat tolerance in a matter of minutes. Nothing can stop it. And it melts right down through the bottom of the plant, theoretically, to China. But of course, as soon as it hits groundwater, it blasts into the atmosphere and sends out clouds of radioactivity. The number of people killed would depend on which way the wind is blowing. Render an area the size of Pennsylvania permanently uninhabitable, not to mention the cancer that would show up later.
The term is really old. It dates back at least into the 60s. And what it means is that the nuclear core melts. And, of course, it's an American term, so it melted from America toward China through the center of the Earth. That's what the term means. It's an over-exaggeration to begin with, but it does mean that the nuclear core leaves the nuclear reactor, leaves the containment, and gets into the Earth. That's what a China syndrome really means. Now, I'll be using some rather crude demonstration items today. I realize a lot of engineers watch this, and just bear with me here. I think these are analogies, and they're always a little risky, but I do think they explain what's happening inside Fukushima. The first phase of the accident was when the nuclear reactor core lost its cooling. Now, you'll remember uranium atoms split. 95% of the power comes from uranium atoms splitting. But these pieces that are left over are called fission products, and they retain a lot of heat. When you shut a nuclear reactor down, a process that takes about 2 seconds, 95% of the heat stops immediately, but 5% of the heat can't be stopped. Now, that, as long as there's extra water flowing, is all you need to keep a nuclear reactor cool. You remember back in April I did a video where I talked about a nuclear reactor fuel pellet. It was about as big as my pinky, and the fuel rod is about the diameter of my pinky, but 12 feet long. In a lot of ways, it's like spaghetti. It's just as flexible as spaghetti, but of course it's 12 feet long. And there are thousands of these nuclear fuel rods inside a nuclear reactor. A nuclear reactor isn't anything but a glorified pressure cooker. A pressure cooker cooks at 15 pounds, a nuclear reactor cooks at 1,000 pounds, but essentially they're the same thing. They're designed to hold really hot water and not to leak. Well, the nuclear fuel is placed into the nuclear reactor, and as long as the water's in there, everything's fine. But like when you overcook spaghetti, what happens? It can form a blob on the bottom of your pressure cooker. That's what happened at Fukushima. The decay products created enough heat to boil off all the water, and the nuclear fuel collapsed. The pasta broke and is now a blob at the bottom of the nuclear reactor. That happened in about 6 to 8 hours on Fukushima 1, and perhaps as long as 10 hours on Fukushima 2 and 3. So the first phase of this accident is called a meltdown. That's when the pasta collapses and lays in the bottom of the pressure cooker. That's when the nuclear fuel melts and lays in the bottom of the nuclear reactor. Phase 1 is a meltdown. The second step in the process is something called a melt through. Now, we're at a point where we've got a blob of nuclear fuel at the bottom of the nuclear reactor vessel. And TEPCO is saying that the nuclear reactor vessel is about 8 inches thick, about 30 centimeters thick, and that's enough to hold the nuclear fuel for quite a long time. I don't think that part of TEPCO's analysis is right. I've talked about it before, but on a boiling water reactor, there's over 60 holes in the bottom of the reactor for the control rods to go in and out. And the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has already identified that it's likely that the nuclear fuel didn't have to melt through the 8 inches of steel, but instead could do an end run around that and shoot out the holes at the bottom of the reactor. So almost like soft ice cream falling out of a dispenser, it's like hot nuclear fuel pouring out of these holes on the bottom of the reactor. That phase is called a melt through. Probably within a day of the beginning of the Fukushima accident, we were in the phase where nuclear fuel was melting through the nuclear pressure vessel. Now remember, the nuclear reaction has stopped. None of this is heat from the chain reaction, and all of it is coming from the nuclear daughter products. After about a day, instead of about 5% of the heat coming from the nuclear daughter products, we're down to less than 1% of the nuclear heat. So now we've got a blob that's left the pressure cooker and is now lying flat on the floor underneath the nuclear reactor. There's some assumptions here. If there was a crater on the bottom of the nuclear reactor, the blob would have fallen into that crater and the heat would have been concentrated. That would have allowed this nuclear blob to work its way down into the nuclear containment faster. And again, that's an assumption. No one really knows what's going on underneath that nuclear reactor. No one can get within 100 feet of the bottom of that nuclear reactor. And it'll be 20 or 30 years before we really find out what that area looks like. But the assumption is that the nuclear fuel lying on the floor has begun to eat away at the containment. So phase two is when it ate through the containment. Phase three is the beginning of what would ultimately become a China syndrome. At the bottom of the nuclear containment is about 3 feet of concrete and about 2 inches of steel. We're quite certain that the nuclear fuel has left the reactor and is lying on the bottom of the containment. The question is how deep into the concrete it's worked its way and has it broken through the steel? I don't think it's broken through the steel, and I think it's perhaps as much as a foot or two into the 3 feet of concrete. But that does not make a China syndrome. The reason it's not working its way down any further is because the radioactive daughter products are no longer generating anywhere near as much heat as they did on the very first day of the accident. In fact, they're probably generating less than 1 million watts of power right now. Now, that's a lot of heat. 1 million watts is 10,000 100-watt light bulbs. And you can imagine that that would generate a lot of heat. But compared to what was available on the first day and the second day and the first week, the amount of decay heat is very small. In addition, right above all this nuclear melted fuel is an awful lot of water. The water's at less than 100 degrees centigrade. It's not boiling. And what that means is that there's an enormous ability for that water to suck the heat out of the nuclear core as it lies on the bottom of the containment. And I don't believe that the nuclear core can melt down through the containment and into the water table. There's been all sorts of postulations about violent explosions from this. And again, I don't think that can happen because the amount of heat available, now we're almost 9 months after the accident, is not great enough to create what's called a steam explosion. So the good news is, I don't think a China syndrome can happen. I don't think this core can keep melting into the bottom of the earth. And I don't think there'll be a steam explosion either. That's the good news. Here's the bad news. That nuclear core is in direct contact with tons of water. And that containment, while not leaking down, is leaking out the sides. That contaminated water is going into every other building on site, and there's literally thousands and thousands of tons of water in other buildings. That water contains radioactive cesium, radioactive strontium, and it also contains nuclear fuel. There'll be uranium in that water and plutonium in that water as well. We know for sure that that water is leaking into the groundwater and into the Pacific Ocean. So while it's important to know that we're not going to release the nuclear core directly into the center of the Earth, the problem isn't over. And as a matter of fact, the problem will last for tens, perhaps even as long as 30 years, because this contaminated water is in the basements of all the buildings on site. And not only does it contain cesium, that hangs around for 300 years, strontium hangs around for 300 years, but it also contains plutonium and uranium, and they have half-lives of tens of thousands of years. So the problem is, what do we do with all that water that's contaminated? It's already leaking into the groundwater. It's already leaking into the ocean. TEPCO is frantically catching it and putting it into tanks. But just today, TEPCO announced that they're running out of tank space on site, and eventually they're going to have to release those tanks into the Pacific Ocean. Now, they'll try to clean up some of the isotopes like cesium, but they have been unable to capture all the strontium. Strontium's a bone seeker that causes leukemia. So we're not out of the woods. We're far from out of the woods. It'll be 30 years before we capture all that nuclear fuel that's underneath that reactor vessel. And until then, it'll be surrounded with water that's leaking into the groundwater. I'll keep you informed as the situation develops. Thank you.